Good evening. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Richard Sommer, Dean of the Daniels Faculty. And it's my pleasure to introduce tonight's featured speaker and the presenter of this year's first bulthaup lecture, the Venerable A.J. Diamond. But first, I'd like to take a moment to thank the sponsor of this event, bulthaup. Bulthaup has generally sponsored lectures of the Daniels Faculty since 2005, which makes this the 10th anniversary of their sponsorship. Thanks to bulthaup's support, we've been able to host public lectures featuring a great range of exceptional speakers from around the world. Past speakers included architects such as Rue Nishizawa from the firm Sana, Liz Diller from the firm Diller, Scavidio & Renfro, and just last year, our very own Mason White and Lola Shepherd from the firm Lateral Office. So, and that's just a tip of the iceberg for all the great lectures that they have helped us create here. For information on this year's other bulthaup lectures, including dates and locations, please visit our website. So before I go on, I want to take the opportunity to thank bulthaup for its continued sponsorship with a round of applause. And now on to our featured speaker. Most of you no doubt already know or are familiar with A.J. Diamond and his work. Indeed, his works and those of his Toronto-based firm, Diamond Schmitt Architects, are nothing less than integral to the new modern face of this city. Mr. Diamond co-founded Diamond Schmitt Architects in 1975 with Donald Schmitt, who will be here tonight, but he's on his way. An alumnus of our faculty who joins us here, who will join us in a few minutes. So prior to this, he worked with the architect Barton Myers. Now, for some of our younger members in the audience tonight, it might be interesting to know that when Mr. Diamond and Mr. Myers split their firm, they eventually went on to establish perhaps the two most important firms in Toronto in Canada. That would be Diamond Schmitt and KPMB, which grew out of Myers' office. I think it's fair to say that most of the architects that are doing important work in this city have been somehow touched by one of these firms. When Mr. Diamond was working with Barton Myers, early on, he designed some landmarks, including Beverly Place, which I think I know as the Hydro Block, a public housing block just south of here. Something I know of only by its nickname, The Booch, the condominium building on Heath Street, and U of T's Innes College, and those are just a few. I'll come back to this, but the housing projects I have just cited are in particular indications of the extent to which Mr. Diamond and his partners have been thinking in forward-looking ways and innovative ways for almost half a century. These housing projects are, for me, more inventive and progressive than much of what we're building now with the boom in condominium construction. For most of you, Mr. Diamond's more recent work in Toronto is the more important touchstone. These projects have helped elevate design and contribute to the cultural life and character of Toronto. These include, and these are just a few, Chorus Quay, which is the first major development on Toronto's waterfront, Bridgepoint Active Healthcare on the edge of the Don Valley, the Daniels Spectrum and Paint Box in Regent Park, and the Metropolitan Toronto Central YMCA. And of course, the city's most important spaces and architectural set pieces, the Four Seasons Center for the Performing Arts at Queen and University. Diamond Schmitt has left its mark here on campus as well, the Earth Sciences Center, the Bahan Center for Information and Technology, and Varsity Center among their works on the downtown campus, which is not to mention recent projects in Scarborough. But while Mr. Diamond's fingerprints can be found all over the city, he and his firm have also been recognized for their work on a national and international scale. The firm has received more than 200 national and international awards, including 6 Governor General Awards for architecture. In the cultural building sector, the firm has been ranked among the world's top 10 architecture firm by the United Kingdom's based journal Building Design. Mr. Diamond's work and the work of his firm can be found throughout North America, Europe, the Caribbean, the Middle East. Notable international projects include the Israeli Foreign Ministry in Jerusalem and the new Mariinsky Theatre in St. Petersburg, Russia. His portfolio of work, both locally and abroad, reveals his commitment to context, intelligent planning, and the value of built heritage and sustainable design. I mentioned the housing that Diamond and Myers did and introduced to the city early on in the 1970s and how innovative it was. What I want to stress is there is a consistent focus on innovation and quiet mastery in Mr. Diamond's best work. That housing was incredibly creative in the way it combined differing building types and circulation systems, and in the way that it introduced modern buildings into what were historic contexts at the time. Now, the innovations in this work are not necessarily in the way the architecture looks, although they do that sometimes too, but more importantly, in how the architecture performs. With the Four Seasons Center, we tend to focus on the gleaming lobbies and entry portico that transform depending on the time of year and the time of day and the light and level of activity in the building. We also focus on the serenity of the almost Scandinavian performance halls. But this building also does many things so well and so invisibly that one might hardly notice, which is how it should be. For example, it packs several halls into a very restricted envelope in which the spaces for music and ballet must be isolated from the vibration of the subways below. And if you think that was easy to pull off, you are probably wrong. And that is what Mr. Diamond means when he says that great architecture depends on great planning and vice versa. Mr. Diamond's contributions are not only as an architect, but to Canadian society and to the city more broadly. He has served as a member of the Ontario Human Rights Commission, as chairman of the Design Advisory Committee for the National Capital, Ottawa, and as a commissioner of the Greater Toronto Area Task Force, which made recommendations on governance, taxation, land use, and transportation for the city. And I should say that if more of those recommendations had been made at the time that that report came out, we would probably be in much better shape today. And Jack and I had a conversation on the recent election and the great hope that there will be more of a focus on, let's say, investing in cities as we go forward. In recognition of his contribution, he is a recipient of the Royal Architecture Institute of Canada's Gold Medal, an honorary fellow of the American Institute of Architects, a member of the Order of Ontario, and an officer of the Order of Canada, making him one of the country's most well-known and decorated architects. He has also received an honorary doctorate from the University of Toronto. Mr. Diamond was born in South Africa. He completed his Master of Architecture at the University of Pennsylvania after studying at Oxford and at his, in his home country of Cape Town. At University of Pennsylvania, he studied with Louis Kahn. I should say that in Mr. Diamond's commitment to architecture as an act of quiet persistence, one can sense Kahn's influence across his entire career. Mr. Diamond moved to Toronto from Philadelphia, actually my hometown, I don't know if you know that, in 1964, when the University of Toronto recruited him to be the founding director of a new Master of Architecture program. So he came to Toronto to teach at this faculty. When we recently celebrated our 125th anniversary, we sent our students out to interview some of the key actors in the faculty's history, and Mr. Diamond was among those. We also compiled a list of all the individuals that had lectured at the faculty over the past decades. I noticed that Mr. Diamond had lectured on several key occasions in the past, but had not been invited back to lecture in some time. And actually, he's done some of his best and most important work during this period, and has lectured about it all over the world, but not here. So it is with great pleasure that I'm able to rectify this oversight and welcome him back to the University of Toronto and to the Daniels faculty to present this evening's lecture. Please welcome Jack Diamond to the stage.
Well, thank you for that very fulsome introduction. I'm quite accustomed to not being welcome here, though. I taught here for 6 years until I got fired. it was an inappropriate firing, as I no doubt you know, I would think. And I had the faculty reinstate me, and then I quit. What I thought I'd do tonight was to go back to basics, to talk about some fundamental issues that we all face, particularly in the world today. It's a world in which we are consuming 1.5 times the products of the world that we can reproduce. So we're diminishing everything, our natural resources, our species, our water. Everything is being diminished in a way that threatens ultimately existence. And I think that what distinguishes a profession from business is that there's an ethical dimension, a social dimension. And I think that's what distinguishes architecture, the social dimension, and an ethical one. And those ethical issues I'm going to refer to. Obviously, the whole question about the consumption of materials is critical to the future of the world, and we can do a lot about it, energy, water, and actual materials. That's just one of the many that I want to deal with, and I think we have a duty to do it, an enormously noble task that may or may not be successful. If you've read Ronald Wright's Short History of Progress, which I recommend you all read, it has an intriguing question at the end. The question is this, that we know that we're a mixture of hominids and of Neanderthals. Now, the Neanderthals' way of survival was collaboration and cooperation. And the way that our species, the one that's predominant, succeeded was by domination and by exploitation. And so he goes on to talk about how, as an example, the Easter Islanders had this cult of building statues to the dead. It started out with little ones. They got bigger and bigger and bigger. And as they got bigger and bigger, they had to roll them into place on logs. And when they got cutting down the last tree in an island which had been self-sufficient, an ecosystem that was self-contained, they knew that when they cut the last log down, that would be the end of their agriculture, their ecosystem, their island, and they cut it down. So the question is, what's going to predominate? The genes that come from the later species or from the Neanderthal species? And there's lots of evidence to say that we've got both those genes. And I think it's a critical question. It may or may not work out successfully. But I think that the other characteristic that we have is that unlike every other animal species, I think, is that we can plan and forecast and plan ahead. And the question is, will we do it wisely? So I want to devote this talk really to, in a sense, to survival. So the 7 points I want to take to talk about. First of all, what people should recognize that the architecture is inevitably an expression of its time. It's inescapable. Secondly, I want to talk about making virtues of necessities. For me, making virtues of necessities is the only way we will have an authentic architecture. I want to talk about economy of means that has a relationship to the savings of materials in the world. I want to talk about conservation in those respects. I want to talk about context. I want to talk about content. And I want to talk about continuity and contrast. Those are the 7 points. So the slides, I hope, will do it quickly. There's no question about who and how this who dominated the world. The pharaohs dominated it for millennia. And they had monuments which were, let me first of all define monument. Monument to me means absolute continuity, that it has longevity beyond normal. And those pyramids are actually at the angle of repose. Even you took off, there's no structure other than itself. So it is in its reposal state. That's why it has that longevity. And it was only somebody with the power of a pharaoh that could do this. And of course, the comparison between that and the way most people lived was extreme. So its expression of the time is clear. From about the 9th century to the 15th, it was clearly the church that dominated. That was clear. You saw the size of the cathedral in comparison to all of what lay around it. And of course, paradoxically, the repudiation of everything Christ stood for. The fact is it became, with Constantine, an imperial device of colonialism. It was, in fact, Constantine that ruined the church. It says that his was the great strength of spreading Christianity. What he did was to make it into an imperial power. And so, far from being humble and chasing the money changers out of the temple, they built more and more elaborate forms of power, and that's absolutely clear. Through the 20th century, the banks, we could see where the dominance lay. What's happening today with the growth of residential types of this kind that dominate the landscape? And in the kooky architecture, which is done for novelty's sake, what's going on? What does this tell us about the world? And to me, it tells us about the same thing as going to Bloomingdale's to buy a pet rock. You could pick it up in the street, but it's better to go pay for it that you could boast about buying a pet rock, which means conspicuous consumption to its reductio ad absurdum. Architecture for me in this respect is doing exactly that. Why would you do that if you could do that? It's so extraordinarily bad that it beggars description. Now let me show you the most recent example of this, perhaps the most egregious example. This is an art gallery in Rome by Zaha Hadid. That's the gallery. The rest is staircase and circulation. There is no place for the art. The consumption of this, in my view, is close to criminal. The way in which there's a wastage and exploitation of what the intents are. Let me go back to basics and some of the most remarkable architecture imaginable. Talk about innovative and minimalist and response to context. Here's a hot, wet climate that has very little change between day and night in temperature in the humid tropics. There's no mud of the kind that you can make, or stone, but there are lots of trees, and there's lots of palm trees. So you build a very light structure out of what the materials are there. You allow the breeze to come in, and you give yourself protection against rain. The body cools by evaporation. So you want the air to pass over your body, slight perspiration to cool the body. And this does it superbly well, and it also beats up in the air, gives you protection from vermin, snakes, and so forth. The opposite is true in the hot, dry climate, where the temperature range from day to night is huge. The diurnal temperature is enormous in the desert. There's tremendous glare, and there are no sticks or stones or trees to build with, but there's mud. So these buildings are built with hugely thick walls, with tiny windows. They heat up slowly during the day, and they cool very slowly at night. And they've got these tiny windows to avoid glare. That's a response that's so remarkable. And the best of all that we have, of course, is, I thought I had the diagram here, is the igloo. The very thing that will kill you, the ice and snow, is the thing you use to protect yourself against the elements. And if you look carefully at the structure of an igloo, it is the best to resist high wind force. The way it's built is of great subtlety, and in fact, it is like a three-dimensional arch. The more you pressure it, the stronger it gets. So there are three examples of saving materials, minimalism, and not using resources in a wasteful way. Those props are clearly, you know what they're doing. They're supporting a wall which could overturn during construction because of the huge force behind it. That principle of a prop to a wall. When I talk about my second point, or third point, the first point was the expression of the age. The second point was the response to context, making virtues of necessities. And this one is just that, because all those flying buttresses are props. The early Norman churches had enormously thick walls, cost money, takes time to build. You want to build really narrow ones, you've got to have something to hold them up. So those pieces became celebrated, and they made a virtue of a necessity. There's a second point to be made. It is that the rose window is lighter than stone, and it appears between the buttresses. You couldn't compose that building by shifting the rose window left or right. It has an inevitability about its position. If you look at architecture today, it's often external decoration. Architects have fun by positioning the windows where they feel. Never mind whether it's good for the view, whether it frames the view, whether it's good for where you sit or walk, or the light it emits, it's a composition. It's inauthentic because it doesn't have that inevitability about its positioning as the rose window does in its most extreme example. That kind of composition, to me, is inauthentic in the extreme. It's when architects don't know what to do that they do everything. I'd like to make this point now, which is the economy of means. Look at that cantilever and how little material there is in supporting it, the continuity of fiber. Taken material by material, this is stronger than the highest tensile steel we produce. These kinds of plants within the oceans that resist enormous pressure and the close architecture. Let me tell you about the exam I once had to take in order to get into a very popular structural engineers course. Lauricola, a very eccentric and wonderful structural engineer, his course was hugely popular. And so he said, well, if you want to take my course, take an exam. So we all went into the room, and there was a skeleton hanging from a scale, human skeleton hanging from a scale. And he said, tell me what you see. That was the exam. So here's what you should have seen. First of all, the scale is a bit of a giveaway. I've forgotten the exact weight, 9 or 11 pounds. That 9 or 11 pounds supports people with 250, 300 pounds. So the ratio of structural weight and material to bearing capacity is enormous. Second of all, you notice that the bones get bigger at the joints to resist punching shear. But they are not thick all the way through. You have a cage here to protect your vital elements. You have a spine that carries vital, that itself is a conduit to all kinds of nerve components. So the structure has an integral form that comes from its precise amount of material used and the least amount of material used as you get in nature. How extraordinarily economic. But the failure of the skeleton, if you look at it carefully, you'll see that it's all hooked together with tiny steel clips or wire to hang the bones together. And it tells you that the skeleton's good in compression, but not in tension. And in fact, torturers know that and try to pull your bones apart. So the fact of the matter is that, it's a bad proof, I know. But the greatest way to enclose volume is, of course, a sphere. So Buckminster Fuller was onto something. The amount of steel that this uses to make that enclosure begins to approach nature in its very, very low levels of factors of safety. Now, in contrast, we have buildings which are done from the back of a napkin. That's the problem. They're designed on the back of a napkin. That's a hell of a way to really figure out what to do, sir, with the structure. Imagine, and you then have to contrive the forms as an artist, like composing windows on a wall, composing shapes for a museum with sloping walls that you're going to hang paintings on. Go figure. The question is, wouldn't it be extraordinary if we worked out a structural form for a gallery that inherently had that resolution between minimal material and the requirements of exhibition, admittance of light, but not strong sunlight, the way in which you could, in fact, mount paintings for show? That would be, to me, a real achievement. A slightly more elegant example, but nonetheless more wasteful. And it's interesting that this is now a white elephant. Well, elephants actually are much more useful than these things. But the fact of the matter is that this is a composition done with extravagant use of material in the most wasteful way possible. I know that this is very immodest to show you this, but it's a bridge we designed for St. Mike's Hospital, where this is a truss. Now, in fact, we could have done, and I try to persuade the engineers to do it, these are simply hoops cling together. It's a three-dimensional truss. But it is the bridge with the least amount of steel for any bridge that I know. And I think that's the accomplishment. And it has an elegance not by arbitrary design, but by an inherent integration of those circular forms which are inherently strong, interconnected to create great rigidity. I think that we could have got those tubes actually smaller, but the manufacturers they agreed that theoretically it was true, but they weren't going to take that risk. But in any event, I was content with that outcome. I'd like to go now on to a question of conservation. We are wasting water profligately. We are consuming it just as badly as we are energy. And I thought I'd show you this example. It's a building that we designed on an island where there is no groundwater whatsoever. So it's not a question of being conservative. You had to do something about it. And I often think, in fact, there's no such thing as planning. There's only a reaction to crisis. So on this thing, if you look carefully, it does a couple of things. Maybe it's too small to see. There's a concrete slab roof, but the beams are upturned to support this deck. The deck is obviously a place where you can, in fact, sunbathe or have dinner or whatever, but it's shading the roof. And to protect waterproofing from ultraviolet, you need to shade it. So this roof is collecting water, it's protecting the roof, and it's providing you with a different surface that you can utilize, and it doesn't look bad like many waterproofed roof does, as an example of a way in which there's an inherent economy in what it does. Now, my firm has been, perhaps, I hope, in the forefront of the concerns of this kind. We have been modeling every building we do to see its performance. And this, and you might not be able to read that from here, but down the left-hand side, the color code is process, which means your computer and plugs and so on, lighting, fans, pumps, hot water, cooling, heating, and renewables. And along this level here, the type of building there are. So we now are modeling every kind of building to know the levels of consumption that they have and where they ought to be. And then you can take measurements to counteract the wastefulness of the normal ways in which we work. The next point I want to deal with is context. This is when we won a competition to do the City Hall in Jerusalem. And I'm unfamiliar with the Middle East. I thought the best way, I really do believe, you don't see anything until you draw it. And it's a tremendously useful thing to do. See if you can do it from memory, and you'll see how wrong you are, because it'll tell you how bad witnesses we are. But also do it in real life, because there's nothing like drawing something to really understand it, especially as an architect. And when we did this whole complex at the City Hall in Jerusalem, I wanted to go back, not to imitate, but to really understand the Mamluk, the great Mamluk Arab architects of the period, whether it was in the souk or whether it was building the walls. And that was the consequence. And there was a wonderful Mamluk device. It's expensive to get big bits of stone, but they had this wonderful scaling. So they would have different colored stones here, but that's two courses. And so by putting the two courses together, you could change the scale of the building. And of course, not a new idea, a hanging garden. It's been done in Babylon, but wrong before us. That in fact, that is now covered in wisteria. And another context of whereby a building, and here's an interesting issue for architecture. I think the most intriguing architectural problems are when you have two conflicting requirements that seem irreconcilably opposed. For example, in the City Hall Square, we want to define the space, but make it accessible to Arab and Jewish Jerusalem equally, to make it permeable. You'd think, how do you define a space and yet make it permeable? In this case, the competition we also won for the foreign ministry. The foreign ministry in Israel is of huge importance. Domestic affairs, all of that, all foreign ministry. And yet, with the parliament building and the national galleries as the really critical ones, all these buildings of state were designed from a planning point of view to define their context of that. And I want to come back to this later on. So how do you put a building in that location? This was an aberration. But how do you put a building in that case where it is both more special and it contributes to the aggregate? So what we did to do that is that certain components of the building, this wall, follow the aggregate to, in fact, produce that enclosure and its continuity. To make it special, the contrast of the roof, not an architect's indulgence alone, but that became the contrasting piece to show it as a special kind of building. And then all other kinds of pieces that we did behind that, when we were very, it was an interesting problem to present it to us in terms of security. I mean, I'd never had to design a building where the garbage box, the garbage bins had to be bomb-proof. Nor when you got out of a car, could you be shot in from a sniper position? Interesting and different kinds of design problems. But you can see here the two different geometries. The wall that is conforming to the sweep of the continuous containment of the public spaces, and the roof that lies behind it, that's quite different. And of course, using onyx in that wonderful context, during the daytime it glows inside, at nighttime it glows through it. And we also had some intriguing design detail problems. Everything that's unfamiliar in Israel is tested in the bomb site in the desert. So this was quite unfamiliar and was taken out to be tested, and we failed miserably. They said you would have killed the whole diplomatic corps with that design detail. So we went back and we did figure out something. You know the way a cannon recoils when it fires but comes back. So each one of these, and they're only about an inch and a quarter wide, has a spring clip. And that one that it receives the blast, but then falls outwards. And in fact, it did work out that way. And the other side of the whole building is quite different. Facing west, you need protection of various kinds. A different context of the colonial architecture of the Caribbean, which does so many great things before the invention of air conditioning, great roofs, an ability to ventilate, just like those sticks and stones I showed, sticks architecture I showed you in the desert. We invented these. In fact, these are bifold counterbalanced shutters that get out of the way entirely, or you can have them down. So it's really a roof with counterbalanced louvered doors that didn't slide or slide and fold and get in the way, but got out of the way. But it then establishes this extraordinary, like almost a platform on the top of that hill. And at times you need, of course, stillness and quiet and heavy winded areas. So now let me turn a little bit to the content. As was introduced by the dean about the four seasons, what we wanted to do was to celebrate the notion of the opera itself. And so we isolated it, not just for acoustic reasons, but for architectural ones, from its surroundings, and then try to celebrate that. So the content of this had many, many demands on it. First of all, music sounds better if it's in a quiet room, axiomatic. But we had a subway right underneath this here. And sirens, which are high-frequency sounds, really penetrate badly. There is also a sense of elitism about opera that was unfortunate to deal with. And they said, we wanted to engage in the city and we want to make it appealing to all ages and socioeconomic grouping. So what we did was to make this entirely transparent and to capture the sidewalk so that you could, in fact, make easy access to it. Second of all, this aerial amphitheater plays a vital role in the 93 concerts a year that are played there. And people going by see people in jeans going to the opera, see it, look, a party going on. And so they removes the mystique of it. That transparency has had this effect. It's the only opera house in North America in which the average age is going down year after year. And it's had a 93% occupancy rate since we began. So architecture can have an effect if indeed you deal with the issues at stake and really deal with them. And we couldn't have thought up the notion of transparency in aerial amphitheater if we hadn't confronted the issue. What are you trying to do? I say to students, say to people in my office, what are you trying to do? What would you consider when the building is finished? What would you consider it success? What would you consider failure? I think those are really critical questions to ask oneself. What constitutes success for this building? And here, there are two things that constitute success in the main. I should say three, but two of the ones I want to mention. During the performance, it's clearly that the singers and the orchestra are the performers. During the intermission, it's the audience. It's a gregarious activity. They want to see and be seen, and therefore the whole play of staircases, of looking up and down, of seeing movement, is part of a gregarious activity that makes it an event rather than watching it alone at home on a video. And the sense of community within it, obviously the horseshoe, the Italian horseshoe form, gives the community that sense. That transparency, though, of really seeing it all, gave us an ability to play with those components, to celebrate making virtues of necessities, and bringing light into it so it was visible from the outside, crucially important. And the fun of detailing it so there's a delicacy about it. It's not ponderous like the old opera houses. And there's this also a theater in Washington, D.C., in which the bay window had its transparency. It comes out into the street where you get views up and down it, and once again isolating the hall itself from its surroundings, both acoustically as well. But shifting ground a little bit to the Niagara Peninsula, in which I think it is one of the examples of good conservation. What we did was, this is the parking lot, and the water off that, because cars, water washed off in rain from cars can be very toxic. So it's washed into reed beds that purify the water before going into the conservation area. And to make a mark on the landscape in a minimalist way, not by some huge extravagant gesture, but to line with the rows of the vines, as well as to give some wind protection to the more delicate vines that were planted nearby. So it sits very carefully in the landscape. And again, a minimalist palette of materials. The trick is how little to do, how few materials to use. And the roof is clearly marking its position, as well as the water that comes out from these reed beds becoming a reflective pond. And within it, the display. Most of the wineries I went into, where the barrels are kept, is in a completely separate place because it's of a different environmental condition. But you would want in a winery to see them. So we made actually the walls between the rooms here these environmentally controlled barrel storage. This whole issue about the way in which you have in the performance during the intermission, making it fun. I'll give you another example in the Mariinsky in St. Petersburg, where we had a great deal of fun playing with the movement of people through those public spaces. And once again, the importance of the performance areas in the lobbies. Lobbies otherwise are dead, not during performances. Here they use the theater not just for lunchtime concerts, but for school children, for classes, for concerts. They're in constant use. much the same kind of issue, but I thought I'd just show you this. We could not have thought up that as decoration. Those differences in the size of space and depth, the forms of these are not designed by whim or by artistic sensibility. Those are acoustically driven. That's what the acoustician wanted. He wanted a certain variety of size, and he gave us from this to this, a variety of depth from this to this. And while we used wood, we also used plaster. And we scalloped that not just to get lighting, but all of those do reflections of the acoustic in the right way. The consequence for me is one of authenticity and satisfaction, because I know it's doing something. There's a reason for it. And the whole other, in St. Petersburg at night, in the summertime, there is no sunset. And so this wonderful landscape is visible from the roof, in which you can see the whole of the city. And I won't belabor this too much, but the point about the narrating the interior on the outside, instead of the easy unity many buildings have, but to be able to read the program, the space program, by virtue of the building's form, is, I feel, deeply satisfying. In fact, we had the pleasure here of actually designing the organ. I mean, most organs now, to me, look like radiators. And so it was fun to do a contemporary one that had a kind of syncopation. Final point I want to make to you tonight is the question of continuity and contrast. We all, I think, without exception, admire such buildings as this in Bath, which has using the aggregate to shape open space. And in St. Petersburg, it's remarkably consistent, with the exception, of course, of that, or that. But what it does to me is that, and here's a lesson that I think we don't yet learn. When you have the aggregate of buildings shaping space, and you have a building that's justifiably different, a church, a cathedral, a parliament building, a great public institution, given its extravagance, and that the rest of this can be made comme ça, not this. This breaks the continuity. There's no justification for that. So the question of judgment about which building should be made special, extravagant, contrast with the continuity of the rest, is something I think we've lost. And in fact, one of the worst perpetrators was Frank Lloyd Wright. He destroyed Fifth Avenue. I mean, a great building, maybe not a great art gallery, great piece of sculpture, not bad, but wrong for the place. He sort of does it at the ground level, but then he removes most of the function, so he kills the street. And you are forced in that gallery to continue. You can't make a choice of gallery. You have to walk the spiral. And you can only see buildings close up or across the spiral. There's no choice of distance or form. So I'm not sure that, while he's much celebrated as from the tectonic and plastic point of view, I'm not sure that it's consistent with its context. But there's, in St. Petersburg, a good example of the St. Isaac's Cathedral sitting on that. I'm not going to go through all of this, but I wanted just to show you that. In fact, the problem here was, how do you do a contemporary building in a highly historic context and not compromise the historic building, but pay honor to the continuity of that context? And this was our answer to it, where the materials are similar, the openings are vertical but syncopated, and instead of the portico being the sign, the signature, or the signifier of the entrance, we made the bay windows do that. And that's a little axonometric, or not axonometric, a SketchUp model of that whole play of the interior. You can see it there, where the height of the building, its continuity, its verticality are all maintained. But what do you do when there's no context? And I'm going to conclude with this example. We're doing this performing arts complex in Lubbock, Texas. Different culture. So extraordinarily different. But there is no context. The little context that there was taken out by an enormous hurricane about 15 years ago. So we are designing something that is really, truly freestanding. And in this vast space, and I found there is this pylon. Actually, it's back here. We're going to move it. The pylon is there that will turn into a piece of electric sculpture to demarcate where this is. Otherwise, I think it would disappear like every other shopping center into the landscape. So you asked me to be 45 minutes. I am.
I asked if, am I on? I asked if we could have a little bit of a question and answer. I get to ask some of the first questions, then we'll see if the...
Nobody wants to ask the first question.
I'm not shy on that. I have a kind of particular large issue that I want to get to, but I thought just on the spur of the moment in terms of where you ended, that I would start where you ended, which is with a pretty provocative statement, actually, that this Buddy Holly... Buddy Holly Hall is in a place that has no context. When we look at this image, it doesn't look anything like downtown Toronto, but it could look like a lot of the periphery of Toronto. So this is an interesting question, how we construe or don't construe places that have either a very recent history or not a built-up history. As a context to work in, and this is a particular issue for Toronto since it's amalgamated, because you were part of the generation that actually helped save the downtown of Toronto and make it, I would say, the vital place that it is today. But we have a whole area among all the amalgamated areas that was built in the post-war period that's quite inconsistent in its fabric, shall we say. Yet to say to people living out there that they don't have a context would be difficult.
No, I think that you're right. No, you're quite right. It's a very unfair statement. I meant, and I should have been more specific, but that would have been beyond 45 minutes.
Exactly. That's why we're going to do it now.
I think that it hasn't got the urban context of street continuity, which is not to be expected in American town. It doesn't even have land use planning. It's the most curious place. Because you can be anywhere and have a lawyer's office in a house and somewhere else a shop and somewhere else something else. I mean, it's just scattered. Mm-hmm. So there's no locus for function. There is a grid of streets which is absolutely unrelenting. So the streets provide the continuity and the context. The context I should have dealt with, which is severe and is one that we have paid a lot of attention to, you cannot believe the dust storms that occur on the plains of Texas, on those high plains. They are overwhelming. I don't think the Sahara has anything like it. Second of all, they told me how badly it rained, and I said, yeah, I've been in places where it rains badly. I wish I could show you that little video. The cars turn to boats. It doesn't rain with raindrops. It's sheets that deluge, and there's no wastewater system that can cope with those enormous surges. So the streets filled with, well, they accept it, and the cars get water up to, or halfway up the car. So many of them stop, they can't go on. And you see this, and I did actually videotape this, which I have. It's quite extraordinary. So you have extremes of weather. There's no question that that's an important
context.
That is a context. Second of all, there is no public transit. It's private automobile. So you have to deal with that. And an odd context, and I'm not joking, I want to tell you this is true. At the hotel I stay in when I go down there, there's a little sign at the door that says that guests are advised not to leave their jewelry or their firearms in the vehicle. And they asked us last time, now there's a new law in Texas where you don't even have to have a concealed weapon, you can have it exposed.
While you go to the drive-thru for your...
And
you go
to the opera, and they said, what do we do about the guns? I said, don't let the critics have them. I don't know what you do with them. So I guess we have a box for them somewhere. I don't know. But it's a different culture. And every project meeting we have starts with a prayer.
So, yeah, that's a context as well.
That's true. But I have to say, they are the most... I don't attempt to talk politics. They are the most generous, kind, courteous, decent people imaginable. There's this extraordinary dichotomy.
And it's celebrating an incredible figure.
And, you know, they are celebrating. But I said to them, you know, it's a 2,200-seat house, 450-seat theater, a 6,000-square-foot multipurpose hall, and a ballet school. The town is 250,000. So I said to them, you know, we're thrilled to have won this project. But can you fill it? Because I don't, you know, ethically I can't say we should build this. Mm-hmm. And they said that's not a problem. I said, what do you mean it's not a problem? They said, well, Texans don't mind driving 2 hours to go to a movie. And if you take Delhi and all of the around here, Amarillo and other places on the high plains of Texas, they said we got enough around there to do it. And it's geared to the few weeks that they'll have Broadway shows, which pays the shot, so the local orchestra. And I think it's actually, I didn't say to them, but you're socialists at heart. I didn't say that. because they've got the money from those big shows to pay for the locals to dance and play and so forth.
So I want to try and tie a few strands together and maybe get back a little bit to some of your roots, because this issue of monumentality and of the way in which you are able to, or the way in which you characterize the overemphasis on iconography and on shape making in the recent history of architecture.
Yes.
If we think about the period of time you were coming out of Penn and the, let's say, the debate between Kahn and Venturi, right, where Kahn said to Venturi towards the end of his life, "Is there truth in Las Vegas?" Right. And where some of the debates and approaches in architecture come from that said, well, when you're building in a context like this, it's actually a lot about iconography, what you see from a car, how the gesture signals things, and that's where some of this trend in architecture came from in the recent generation. I would agree to you that maybe it has no place in the middle of a city, but in fact, it was in the hands of some smart people a way of dealing with a place that had a very, even for someone like Frank Gehry in Los Angeles, a very incongruous and mixed context.
Well, I would place it in a slightly different context. It's obviously well understood that we have enormously powerful globalizing forces now. And it's not a surprise to me that the opposite of that is the fierce nationalism and identity of small nations. So I think that the desperate countervailing force to globalization is the attempts at identity at small nations everywhere. And I think that the two slides that I should have dealt with this question that you raise, if you see all of these anonymous apartment buildings going up, I'm not surprised you've got all those quirky things that architects do. So I think that it's maybe that there are, just as there is in terms of globalization and the countervailing force of individualism and power in the expression of small, whether it's ISIS or whomever, desperately establishing some tribal or personal or group identity, perhaps architects are revolting against the kind of mindless anonymity and continuity of the high-rise apartment building that's now ubiquitous. And those quirky things are that attempt, like the small nation state, to give itself identity. Perhaps those are the two things that are working at large.
Yeah.
Now, when architects do it on grand projects and don't use their judgment as to whether it's justified to celebrate a building to that extent or to see to it that it, in fact, is part of the aggregate, that's when there's failure, in my view.
I mean, this is interesting because last year, I think it was about a year ago, when Frank Gehry was attacked after the opening, it was at the Louis Vuitton Center in Paris, and he said, why are you attacking me when 90% of what gets built in the world is crap? You know, I'm trying to do something artful in a very small lane here, and why is that a problem?
Well, I think that things go around. You know, once upon a time, coffee was considered bad for you. Now it's considered wonderful. Fat was considered bad for you. Now it's considered okay. I'm sure sugar's going to come around. But anyway, I think that his 90% maybe become celebrated, and the 1% that he designs for won't be.
Yeah.
So I think that it depends on your perspective. I mean, conspicuous consumption by those who are deprived of housing doesn't look good. And so he really is an architect of the 1%.
Even though, oddly enough, he started out by
his Chain architecture,
by making reference to a kind of depraved vernacular. So let me switch gears with you a little bit, because I'm thinking back to a conversation we had a number of years ago about the nature of practice, about what faculties like this have a responsibility to do in educating students.
Yes.
And you told me that we talked a lot about the way the practice is changing, the scale of your office, and what you believe is necessary as a business, really,
right,
in order to undertake architecture properly. Because when you show projects where you're investigating structural solutions, where you're looking at complex problems of building science and sustainability, that can only be sustained either through massive collaboration with external consultants or by constructing that expertise internally. So could you speak a little bit to how your evolution, how you've evolved in your thinking about how to make architecture work, not just as a business, but as a practice?
I'd be happy to do that. First of all, I'd make the point that when I was at architecture school, there was a point of honor not to know about money.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow it was the wrong thing, but that's extraordinarily stupid. Most people want reward. I do believe that architects are deeply satisfied by the work they do. I think there's nothing that can supplant that. But they also want to have a decent life and live well, not to have to worry about the money, at least. So I think that paying attention to the fact that it's profitable is a decent thing to do if you distribute it fairly. Obviously, some architects don't. But I think that, but seeing to it, and being profitable means that you have continuity, that in fact you can maintain a task. I think that now the world is stacked against the small practice. Not that small practices can't derive enormous pleasure of doing small things, but it's difficult to build a clientele or a reputation on that. Some people do it. Bridget does it. There are people who do that. So, but it's not easy, and that's usually exceptional. What I think that we've managed to do, and I think the success has come from the people in the office, it's an amazing group of people, extraordinary group of people, is that we have maintained an atmosphere of the studio, experimentation and excellence in an office big enough to support a researcher, a librarian, and certain levels of specialization, which we fight against. But there is a certain level of that. And I think that maintenance of the way in which that is devolved in the office is crucial. I mean, I'm very proud to say that we're the only architectural office in Canada that has been nominated one of the 50 best managed companies. And it's not just the bottom line, it's how you manage. And I can give people here just a sense of how that works. There are 17 owners of the company who have shares in the company or actually are owners. That 17 constitutes the board. That board is also seen as a cabinet. Each one of them has a practice-wide responsibility in addition to their project work. So if one of them, pick any subject you like that's practice-wide, IT or computer programs, whatever, and they say, you know what, we're not on the leading edge of this. So we say to that person, put a small committee together, not from the board, outside in the office, and if you need expertise beyond that, get it. come back in a month's time. We meet, that group meets once a month. Come back with a paper to tell us what we should do. And they come back and say, here's where we are. It's the old way of writing a report. Here's where we want to go. Here's how we get there. And then we listen to it. And of course, we say, what'll it cost? And we make a decision. And as a consequence, I think we stay on the leading edge of every aspect of practice. Because it is, in fact, a devolution of responsibility to lots of people who have a stake in doing it well. And I think that, look, people will give their lives in a great cause. People fought in wars because they believed in what they're doing. They give their life. Most people in the world want to be involved in something bigger than themselves. People feel ennobled by that. And if you can convey in an office that what you're doing is not just making another building, but doing it for a larger purpose, people feel enabled and inspired by that. And I think that to have that sense in the office that what we're doing is important, and why I say to a group like this, if you can save material, if you can work out a better method of conservation, if you can give a social dimension to your work in which the users feel good, you're making a contribution that is not just... The world is divided between those who want to do something for others than just for themselves. And I think the profession is the perfect place to do that.
So what's interesting is over the past, I don't know, 5-10 years, especially after the economic downturn in 2009, there were a lot of consolidations and firms being bought out.
I know. I had to introduce two partners to each other. They were in a different city. They didn't know they belonged to the same firm.
Yeah, I have a peer who was devoted.
You know who they are.
devoted his life to a more boutique practice that recently went to work for Gensler, and he said, "Well, now I'm on the inside. I understand why I wasn't getting any work before." But some of these firms have thousands of employees and have a structure that's quite different than the one you're describing.
Yes.
So I want you to speak to two questions about structure and size, and also the importance of being rooted in a place, because you're practicing internationally, but Toronto in Canada has been the anchor for what you do. I mean, do you think that's, how important is that going forward?
Well, first of all, there clearly is room for a very wide array of practices and attitudes, clearly. We have avoided, we once tried an office in Ottawa, it's remote. We lost control, we lost money. I think we probably lost reputation. So it didn't seem like a good idea. So what we do is make strategic alliances. We kick tires, we find the right partner in any city that we work away from home, and they contribute, and we're not ungenerous about the fee, we split the fee. They earn their keep, and they know a local scene, and we're happy to do that. Just out of interest, I love the derivation of words. The origin of the word company. Do you know what it is? In the 12th century, people put together a deal. And I found it from The Merchant of Prato. There's a wonderful Iris Arrigo edited a book about The Merchant of Prato. In the 12th century, one thinks of the medieval world as very constrained. Mm-hmm. He was buying wool in the Cotswolds. He was carding it and spinning it in Prato. He was having it dyed in Spain, and he was selling it to the papal court in Avignon. But it took time, and there was risk. So they would spread the risk by joining in partnership with others. They'd assemble the wool and in a warehouse, and they would live above it. And of course, living above it, they would have food together, compane, with bread.
Yeah, it's interesting. We had, in that vein, an incredible scholar, Mark Yarzenbach, here last week, who gave a lecture, actually, University College, on Caritic architecture, and he went through the origin of the word corridor, which turns out to be the corrados, who were part of the Spanish Empire, who were the gentlemen like musketeers that were sent out to spread and to run for the empire. And the first corridors were basically the spaces where they would run to the people who were in charge. And he evolved that into when it became part of architecture and terms like the corridors of power or lobbyists, which all have their origin in social practice.
Bullfight.
Yeah. So which I think resonates with this notion that architecture in the end or starts with a kind of social
That's a great
compact.
Dimension. I mean, we're so lucky because we are given the vehicle to make lives better and to do things for our communities. I mean, it's a gift.
So in your life in the office, now I'm going to go into some dangerous territory here. In your life in the office and the young people you're encountering coming out of not just our school, but the schools in general, what are you seeing as strengths and weaknesses in terms of their capacities?
Well, I must say, I'm a different generation, but I don't understand how you can conceptualize a project without sketching it. One of the dangers, I think, on the computer, it looks cooked. It looks ready to build. And I'm not sure it's had all the consideration it should. It has that kind of imprimatur of precision and conviction because it was all laid out so perfectly. But I'm not sure how much consideration it has, and that's on the one hand. On the other hand, because you have programs like Rhino, and you now have laser systems that can build almost anything, we do. And I'm not sure that it's justified. Because you can do it doesn't mean you should. I mean, we have the atomic bomb. Because we've got the atomic bomb doesn't mean we should use it. And I think that we've got those sort of mini bombs in our computers that you can draw any damn shape and build it.
And we have gone through a whole period where there's, in a sense, a great enthusiasm about what we can do with geometry, again, because we have the software and other things.
But
I think we're moving towards a more calmer and balanced attitude towards, as you say,
once,
what you
once
can.
Once I think where people get to know that these are tools that have to be used with judgment, I think that if you pay the attention to the professionals I'm trying to convey about consider what's success and for whom are you designing. I mean, I used to say when I taught to students at critiques, what you've done sounds very consistent with what you intended to do. And that's what I call an internal consistency. What should you be doing? What's the external consistency? What's the object of this? For whom are you designing?
So, in a related question, how are you finding the nature of clientele today in institutions and other people?
There are lots and lots of different kinds, but very sophisticated. And I think that one of the things that's worked well is the lead system. Very interesting. Once upon a time, there was no currency to conservation and environmental responsibility and sustainability. Now, as faulty as it is, it's got a calibrated currency. You get so many points for doing this, that, and the other thing, and you can measure it, and therefore you get a stamp of housekeeping, good approval, or get a silver or a gold or maybe a platinum stamp of LEED qualification. And so that even the most ordinary builder now has a means of measuring the conservation, which is a hugely strong thing. But a very surprising thing happened to us, coming back to your question about a client who builds a lot of office buildings of the sort of medium kind in the suburbs, came to us and said he'd like us to design their buildings for them. And I said to him, you know, I know your buildings and I know who you use as architects. Are you sure you want to come to us? Because our fees are not at the rock bottom. And he said, yes, we know that, but we want you to do it. And I said, tell me why. He said, I'll tell you why. We want to have a LEED certified buildings because our tenants are saying to us, is it LEED certified? Because they know the utility costs will be less. There's an interesting insight of coming right around that the market in some respects is now being imbued by the LEED standard and saying, here's what works. I think we're rambling on. We're probably boring everybody to tears.
Should we take some questions out here? That's not really an outside question, Robert.
You want to start with the outside
question? No, go ahead.
Thank you for an interesting lecture. I have enormous sympathy for the ethical project that you lay out for architecture, but I also something that is left out that is hard to speak about, which is that aspect of design, which doesn't it isn't determined by all of these ethical considerations. I mean, even in your window pattern for, I think it was the Russian project, the syncopated one, I mean, that in a sense is a question of style. And I think about the fact that that part of what people are looking for in architecture, what attracts them to it, is something which is, in a sense, you know, a denigrated concept, but it's style, or to build in style, and that always is beyond, it always falls outside of those questions of ethical problem solving, efficiencies, and so forth. And at the far end of the extreme is Philip Johnson's remark that architecture is the art of wasting space.
The art of what?
The art of wasting space. And yes, I know he was a bad boy. He liked to be a bad boy. But there is something about the way in which the only way to justify, for instance, the expenditures from public coffers is to express your commitment to parsimony, when in fact the great spaces of the past have often been extravagant. I mean, even Union Station. So I wonder if there's something that you might say along about the question of grandeur and style.
Your question's a tremendously important one. Let me pass it in two respects. One is, I think that if you're making the right decision, for example, the windows being vertical and so forth, once you've done that, then it's a question of handwriting. And you can do it more or less elegantly. You can detail it better or worse than someone else. So I think that in principle it's correct, but I agree with you that of course there is the artistic sensibility, inevitably, good or bad. There isn't any question about that. That's part one. And I accept your distinction completely. And of course I'd be the last person not to, because I want to make beautiful, elegant buildings that are deeply satisfying over a long period of time. And it's not purely on the metrics of all of those quantifiable components. No issue about it. It has to be elevated. And in fact, I mean, while social dimension is the aspect that elevates architecture from building, there's another way you can also say that. If you can make an element of architecture do more than its basic functional component, you're on your way to doing that. For example, a column. A column has to support something. I mean, that's what it's there for. But if it modulates light, if it calibrates the space, if it announces an entrance, if it's used symbolically as well, then it's architecture, not building. So I think that you could deal with it in that respect. The second part, the way I'd pass your question, is that there are times when you do an extravagant thing, like the Cathedral of the Spilt Blood, that extraordinary onion dome cathedral in St. Petersburg. And the position of the church, whether I agree with it or not, and obviously from what I've said, I don't, the fact is that the church had an enormous impact and was important in terms of Russian culture and belief. And therefore, giving it importance, giving it significance, meant that you would have something special. So I think it's justified in that respect, just as the railway stations of Canada through that period of huge importance. So yes, there are times when you say, I think it's worth spending more than it's than the basic utility requires. But it's judgment. But it shouldn't apply universally, which is what we tend to do, because now we're driven by career, where you want to be identified immediately by something exceptional. The magazines only put on the cover something that's outrageous. And real estate people want an immediate address. Those are the three things that drives this eccentricity.
Over here.
Could you walk us through the Roberts Library and like your process with that? Like, could you just give us a brief walk down of like
Library? I can't hear.
The Roberts Library, you guys are rebuilding, you guys are doing an extension on the Roberts Library at U of T?
The addition you're doing.
Well, yes.
And like, just give us your thoughts, like, and maybe juxtapose it to the Snohetta piece they did, the Student Learning Center at Ryerson. Can you like maybe a brief juxtaposition and maybe a walkthrough on like your process and like your thoughts on it and like what you're incorporating and whatnot?
Well, that would be a whole other lecture.
Okay, then maybe not. game off.
It might be more interesting for you to speak about And I don't know how involved you were in the project for Robards, but Robards is an interesting challenge, and it comes from a moment in architecture that in a way slightly precedes the moment you came into architecture, where, you know, the moment of, I mean, it's not Paul Rudolph. Well,
it was known as Fort Book.
Right, but the architecture is a kind of monumental brutalism, which many people reacted against, and we have a lot of it in Toronto. You could say it's a part of our history now. So I guess to abstract his question.
I think that the attempts that we made, and I've not been involved in it that much, but the attempts were, first of all, to humanize the interior spaces, to rationalize them, and to build an addition which would be light in contrast to the main one. And I mean, the objectives of that are pretty clear. In fact, it was to de-brutalize it. Anyway, everybody's going to get... Have you had dinner yet?
One more question. We're, you know, it's been a long time, so we have to get our full a full store.
You mentioned a little bit about talk about the small practice.
Yes.
And what would you say as sort of your experience? I imagine when you started it, I imagine that was a small practice.
And it was one room in this building. It's true.
So what, I mean, whether it's an event or maybe client or what have you, as a project, what do you think is sort of made a big difference, like say, looking back?
Honestly, I think it was several things that worked in our favor. We were lucky. But while I was teaching here, I took the teaching post on the condition I could practice. Mm-hmm. And what I usually do when I teach, and I used to teach in other places as well, I would go to the local municipality or city and say, what's the worst problem you've got? What's really a problem? And then make that the studio problem. And then I'd say to the city, and particularly here, when I joined it, people were designing golf courses and stuff. And it's, I mean, nothing to do with the city whatsoever. There was a disconnect between the school and what was going on, vitally going on downtown. And so, and I'd say that, you know, if we succeed, you can, hopefully it'll influence your policies and you'll do it and you can take credit. And if we don't, you can say, oh, those damned academics, what do they know? So. And so I went to the city here, in fact, said to them, what's your biggest problem? They said, well, they're going to build a hydro station on Beverly and Huron, and it's going to demolish a whole bunch of houses, and it's zoned for that. I said, okay. So we made that a student project of how we could, in fact, increase the density of that area without demolishing it, and it got picked up. Again, a bit of luck. There was a program that London Life did. It was about life. It started with birth and kids, and then was one of them was where you live. And they said, would you do this program on where you live? And we did this program to show two things. One is that you could increase density by building infill without demolishing what's there, and you could build buildings at a density that was the same as high-rise. And they said, no, you can't do that. I said, I'll show you. And during the show, it was a completely inadvertent move. We'd built a model of a high-rise building on a block of land, and we'd showed the houses that surrounded the land and building on the back lanes and so on. And I said, the densities are the same. And they looked skeptical. So I picked up the high-rise building and broke the model and turned it on its side. And they could see that two things are the same. And that got us exposure. And then the residents of that area got us built into the bylaw to actually do the housing. Crombie came along. And I would say the second thing is getting involved politically. I got involved with the Crombie campaign because he wanted to do the right things and he was listening to us. And so the city's nonprofit housing corporation came about with that. And then we did the actual Beverly Place, became a project. So, and at the same time, we stopped the developer continuing St. Jamestown. So the rest of the profession, I can tell you, I was not popular. I was told I was biting the hand that fed us, and I was being difficult and, you know, should shut up. Of course, that's the best thing they could say to me. That's red rag to a bull. Anyway, so I think that getting engaged in the city, getting engaged in public issues in which we are better to speak to than anybody else, that's what we should be doing. There are issues in the city that require... Let me give you a good example. Right now, there's this question of whether they should build a subway in Scarborough or an LRT. The LRT that's been designed and financed would serve 5 stations, would be used to almost capacity, and be built sooner than a subway. A subway's capacity, much greater, is not justified. It would cost $1 billion more, serve 3 stations, and take much longer to get there, and trigger costs on the existing line that you would have to improve the signaling in order to get this done. The populist thing is, oh, those poor people in Scarborough, they get a raw deal. The rest of the city's got subways, why don't they? It's a populist appeal. Even this government, who's been pretty good about many things, has gone along with it. They went along with supporting it. This mayor has supported it. Everybody in this room could say, this is a crock. It's $1 billion more, take longer to build, it will never be used to capacity, isn't going to serve the people it's intended for. There's an issue right now you could make an issue of and get your name in the paper.
And use your skills as an architect to help actually show it.
Yes.
By the way, there's a fascinating show that just was mounted last week at the Canadian Center for Architecture called The Other Architect, which is a history of the last 50 years of architects getting involved in alternate forms of organization. Some that I had never heard of, like I didn't know Charles Moore had a television show.
Is that right?
Where people could
call.
But
did anybody watch it?
People would call up and he would do schemes for them on the show.
Yeah. See me later.
So, but there were other ones that were a bus that traveled around. So I think this idea of actually reconceptualizing practice by engaging this way is an extremely important thing to think about for those of you who are starting out.
Anyway, thank you.
Okay, I think that's a good place to end. Thank you so much for the lecture.